Now, let me just throw out some statistics on the state of the socio-economic crisis. I think this is very well known. More than, you know, almost half the population lives on less than 250 a day. And every day there are 29,000 children dying because of poverty and lack of health resources. And we have 1.2 billion people suffering from hunger. In the US, the richest country in the world, in 2007, there were 36.2 million people, that is one in every 8 person in the United States, who suffered from hunger. Over 9 million people die worldwide each year as a result of hunger and malnutrition. 5 million are children. Now, at the same time, you have a situation where in the, you know, in the developed countries, as well as among our elite, we are so over-consuming and we become obese. So you have this great disparity between a very significant population in the world and a small elite who are enjoying the benefits of what we produce. The South Commission, in its report in 1990, warned about the instability and conflicts that would arise from global disparity. It read, were all humanity a single non-state, the present North-South divide would make it an unviable semi-feudal entity split by internal conflicts. Its small part is advanced, prosperous, powerful. Its much bigger part is underdeveloped, poor, powerless. A nation so divided within itself would be recognized as unstable. A world so divided should likewise be recognized as inherently unstable. And the position is worsening, not improving. I think this was written almost 21 years ago. And I don't think the situation has improved despite all the pledges that the governments have made during the millennium session of the United Nations. Now, as far as the ecological crisis is concerned, we are really heading towards a situation where it threatens our own very existence. More than 24 ecosystem services, of all the 24 ecosystem services assessed, almost 60% are degraded. And we have a situation where, you know, many conferences have been held to deal with the question of climate change, which has been brought about as a result of the abuses of the industrial society, and yet none of the governments have committed themselves to something that will resolve this problem. And this is a very serious problem. Now, we know that if the temperature goes up by 3 degrees centigrade, 250 to 500 million extra people will be at risk of hunger, more than half in Africa and Western Asia. Now, the global warming is largely due to the developed countries. They produce, I mean, US alone produces 25% of worldwide greenhouse gas pollution. And yet, the countries that suffer from this are the developing countries. For example, Africa with 14% of the world's population contributes only 3% of the global greenhouse gas emission. And this includes all the cutting of forests, the mining that is done to support the lifestyle of the developed countries. And yet, many of the natural disasters are now occurring in Africa. Now, given this situation, what are the universities, what is the role the universities are playing in order to make the students conscious of these problems, make them look for the roots of this problem, to find solutions for this problem? In my view, I don't think the universities have undertaken this task. In fact, the education we are giving is what Churchill calls white studies, a colonial construct of thought and action that first and foremost has taken over the minds of people in the West, but which has since become a global phenomenon. In fact, we are teaching things, we are doing things that are actually upholding the system that is destroying this globe. We are not teaching the students the way to stop this destruction. In fact, the knowledge that they carry is the knowledge that contributes to the destruction. And this is because its underlying philosophy is materialism, which regards physical matter as the only or fundamental reality. There is no place for God, spirit, or soul, or anything sacred in this worldview. Knowledge is decoupled from religious and ethical values. Its reductionist scientific methodology seeks to find a single cause to explain a phenomenon of behavior. It views things in isolation and does not see the interconnections and relationships. I mean, for a reductionist scientist, a forest is just a collection of trees, you know, animals, microorganisms, etc. They don't see the interrelationship and how one needs the other, how we ourselves need the existence of the forest for keeping our climate and other aspects. Now, this is the type of knowledge we're imparting to our students. Moreover, the function of universities is increasingly becoming utilitarian, producing skilled workers for the capitalist system. Their focus is on imparting information and developing analytical skills in specialized areas which are needed by the system. With the privatization mania in full swing, corporations are influencing the direction and content of university education. Practical science and technology are given special importance while the humanities are neglected. Many universities have closed down their philosophy departments because they are perceived to have no utility value. Now, also education has become a high-valued commodity which can bring you a good income after graduation. A degree is seen as a passport to a well-paying job and acquisition of material goods. Now, medical knowledge is no more an instrument to serve the sick, especially the poor and needy, but a commodity to be sold and purchased in the market. The same can be said about other professions, including lawyers, teachers, and architects. Scientists, popularly imagined to be cloistered in their laboratories, experimenting and pushing back the frontiers of scientific knowledge, are now in the marketplace, involved in business to develop and market genetically engineered products. The symbiotic relationship between scientists and corporations, particularly in the pharmaceutical and genetically modified food industries, has led to many fraudulent claims which have cast a long shadow on the integrity and reputation of scientists. Universities are producing graduates with tunnel vision, unable to see the interconnection between different branches of knowledge, different parts of nature, and different aspects of reality. An architect designing a township would readily sacrifice a forested hill in order to maximize the profit for his employer without understanding the relationship between the hill, local climate, and rainfall. Any fracturing of that relationship could produce floods, drought, and increased atmospheric temperatures. Also, the biodiversity will be gone with the plants, trees, birds, animals, and microorganisms eliminated. His tunnel vision is the result of fragmenting knowledge about reality into various branches and locating them in separate departments with very little communication and interaction between them. White studies breeds an inferiority complex in the students, leading to worship of knowledge from the West and contempt for local traditional knowledge. A graduate with his knowledge of agriculture based on high use of harmful chemicals will be contemptuous of the farmer who has an intimate knowledge of the relationship between between seed, soil, microorganisms, water, crops, and pests derived from traditional wisdom passed down through generations. The Western way of knowing reality is implanted in the minds of the students to the exclusion of traditional ways. As Churchill explains, the system of Euro-supremacy domination depends for its continued maintenance and expansion, even its survival, upon the reproduction of its own intellectual paradigm, its approved way of thinking, seeing, understanding, and being. to the ultimate exclusion of all others, white studies simply cannot admit to the existence of viable conceptual structures other than its own. Now, decolonization did not lead to the emergence of institutions of higher learning rooted in our traditions, culture, norms, and values. Our leaders merely continued the colonial tradition with minor changes and replicated it on a wider scale. On the continuation of the colonial heritage, Dri T. S.E. Lumumba, I hope I'm pronouncing the name correctly, in her monograph on higher education in Africa writes, "Thus, considering education an instrument of colonization and control through culture, Africans in general, and especially African leaders, were calling for colonization by choice. And education decision makers were, without careful consideration of the long-run consequences, engaging themselves, their countries, and future generations on the track leading to a dependency trap." Lumumba calls for designing an indigenous educational paradigm from pan-African or continental perspectives. She writes, quoting earlier work done by her and others, "Education in its various disciplinary forms, including its philosophy, science, technology, and knowledge base, must be reconnected to Africa's culture. It is imperative that African philosophy provides the foundation of African education." Contrasting the individualism of the West with the African focus on the community, she writes, "In the general African ethos, to be is necessarily to be in relation to others, and the center is a human being who is free and at the same time highly dependent upon others. On the memory of the past and on emphasizing the balance between nature and culture, in the African ethos and practical life, this connection with others is essential." The connection transits through the common culture. The connection to others is not a mere juxtaposition of individuals living side by side who only draw resources from the same cultural source and have the same reference. Rather, they experience together their cultural expression and the use of culture. For those graduating from our universities, the Western paradigm provides the mental framework for their thinking, analyzing, and conceptualizing in whatever field they are working. After graduation, they will occupy positions of power and influence in our society. Political leaders, captains of industry, economists, agriculturists, lawyers, judges, administrators, teachers, doctors, and even religious scholars who graduate from these universities. The civilizational crisis we face today requires a radical change in our worldview. Values, education, production and consumption of goods and services, and social relations. The elite, including political leaders, educators, and policymakers, would not be amenable to such change because they do not appreciate that the crisis is rooted in the Western paradigm, which has been internalized in them and become part of their mindset. We need to bring back religion and ethical values to what we teach in the universities. The focus of education should be to inculcate values and develop character to become good human beings, and not for merely acquiring skills to become cogs in the capitalist machine. Now, the next part I'm dealing with is, how do we challenge this Western paradigm? The Western paradigm must be challenged in the different branches of knowledge taught in the universities. Now, when a student goes through university education, if he goes through an economics course, he is only exposed to the Western paradigm. He has no knowledge of other paradigms, that there are other ways of building economics, other ways of producing, distributing, producing and distributing other than what the Western paradigm teaches him. So, unless you expose the person to these other paradigms, when he goes, he becomes a policy maker, he becomes a political leader, he only carries in his mind this paradigm. Everything else is impossible.